Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. This will be a course related to some foundational aspects in algebraic number theory. And it is centered around class field theory and its generalizations. So we have here some students from Kyoto University. I don't know how many, but it will become clear later. And these students are supposed to pass something which corresponds to this course. So there are two ways to get some credit. One is to ask questions. Especially at the beginning of the next lecture, please ask questions about the previous lecture. So I will be very happy to answer any questions if asked. And the second way to get some credit or marks is to solve exercises. So I will include in the lecture some exercises. Today there will be maybe two exercises. And if you solve it during this course of lectures, please pass your solution in written form to me. These exercises are not usual exercises. They are a little bit more difficult than usual exercises. So if you cannot solve them, do not be disappointed. If you can solve them, then please tell me. So today it will be rather an easy lecture. It will be like a survey of certain things, and then I will already start to talk about concrete mathematical theories. But overall, today's lecture is not very difficult. So I hope that some of you will come to the second lecture. So, because the first lecture will be not very difficult. So if we have a field K, then of course we are interested in its absolute Galois group, which is the group of symmetries. Which is the Galois group of separable closure of K over K. And often also we are interested in the most simplest object associated to this group, which is in general topological profinite group. But it does not need to be abelian. So we're also interested in its maximal abelian quotient, which is just the quotient of this group modulo its commutator. In this case, the commutator coincides with its closure, so the commutator is a closed subgroup of the absolute Galois group. So this is a Hausdorff space. It's abelian topological profinite group. And so now let's consider an example, which historically was one of the first to be studied. So this example is Kummer theory. Which is in modern language some easy linear algebra. So this is just some easy linear algebra, nothing really special. So choose an integer m, which is prime to characteristic of the field K. And then we have an exact sequence of GK modules, which just contains m's roots of unity, and then multiplicative group of the separable closure, and then again itself. And this is just raising to the m's power. So because M is prime to characteristic of the field K, it's a standard exact sequence. And then we just can apply Galois cohomologies, and so we get the Kummer map. Which is a homomorphism of GK fixed elements of this field, or this module. This is just a very standard thing. It's just the first cohomology groups involved only, and they can be explicitly defined without using any cohomological formalism. And so this is H1 theory. So later we'll see examples of H2 and HN, where N is greater than 2 series. But this is just H1 theory. So it's as easy as it can only be. So in particular, so far I did not assume that roots of unity are in K. But if all these roots of unity are in K, M's roots of unity are in K, then H1 gets slightly simpler. Namely, we can replace roots of unity by the cyclic group of order M. And then we get the so-called Kummer pairing. This Kummer pairing is just again use the same quotient we already seen, and the second will be something coming from the Galois group. So consider the quotient of the maximal abelian group by its commutator and the closed subgroup generated by all M's powers, which I denote just like this. And so the values are again taken in Z mod M. And it should be clear how this Kummer pairing is defined. So this is isomorphic to this, and this is equal to this. So these are homomorphisms. These are just homomorphisms. This is the same as homomorphisms, continuous homomorphisms from this absolute Galois group to Z mod M. So these are homomorphisms. These are homomorphisms from this group to Z mod M. So apply homomorphism to a group element, and you get Z mod M, an element in Z mod M. So this is very trivial pairing. And also part of Kummer theory is Kummer correspondence. Kummer correspondence is something very easy, and it says that finite abelian extensions of exponent, well, M or exponent dividing M, depending on what do you mean by exponent, are in one-to-one correspondence with subgroups B in the multiplicative group of K, which contain M's powers. And this correspondence goes like this. B goes to the field extension of K, which is generated by extracting all M's roots of elements of subgroup B. So this is one-to-one. So the reason why I just spent time on listing this very elementary linear algebra result, elementary from modern point of view, is that in class field theory is basically attempt to extend this in a non-trivial way to arithmetic fields. So if we start with, so for example, Kummer theory becomes more and more interesting the more roots of unity the field K contains. But arithmetic fields typically contain very few roots. They are very far from algebraically closed fields. And so we are interested in arithmetic fields. And I will discuss various generalizations of this theory, Kummer theory, to arithmetic fields. And generalizations will be always non-trivial and not linear algebra stuff, but more sophisticated than that. So arithmetic fields, examples like the field of rational numbers, the field of periodic numbers, they are finite extensions. Or for example, rational functions over Q, formal power series over Q, and many other examples. And also this is just characteristic zero, but we also have a lot of objects in characteristic P. So these are kind of arithmetic fields. And we start to apply Kummer theory, for example, Q. Q contains only two roots of unity. So not much interesting. There is some small trick, which is in particular heavily used in algebraic case theory, that at least you can apply Kummer theory if you add L's roots of unity, where L is prime. So then you get L's root of unity in this field, so you can apply Kummer theory for M equals to L to this field. And then because the degree of this extension is prime to L, it is L minus 1, because it's prime to L, then you can get a lot of results about extensions of degree of exponent L of Q by using Kummer theory here and the fact that the degree is prime to L. But you cannot go further than just prime L. For example, for L square already, it's much more difficult to get explicit description of extensions of degree L square, even of the field of rational numbers, using Kummer theory. So all constructions becomes complicated, and for applications not very useful. Because in Kummer theory the absolute Galois group plays fundamental role, then of course here we also interested to know, to have some information about absolute Galois groups of such fields. And so the situation is complicated. It's not really true, but approximately, in the first approximation, we still know almost nothing. Well, still know almost nothing, but still something is known, in particular using class field series. But still, we know almost nothing about the absolute Galois group of Q. We know many results, some of which are very powerful, but still we know much less than we want to know. And here in particular there is very famous Shafarevich conjecture, which is already half forgotten, as well as many other things about which I will be talking, which says that the commutator of the absolute Galois group of Q is free. It says that this is a free profinite group in the category of profinite groups. So this conjecture is still not proved. It was stated more than 50 years ago, and it's still not proved. And apparently nobody is trying to prove it. At least I have not seen anything related to attempts to prove it. So we'll see a little later that a local version of this conjecture is true, but the global version we still don't know. So this is about Q, and then if, for example, we ask about the absolute Galois group of local fields with finite residue field, for example, GQP, and it's closed subgroups of open subgroups of finite index, then there we know a lot. So there we know topological description in terms of topological generators and relations for all local fields. Well, there are some problems when P equals to 2, but approximately we know everything. Generators and relations. So we have a full description of the absolute Galois group of local field in terms of as a topological group. But there is one problem, which is that its topological generators are not all of them are of arithmetic nature. And in particular, we still don't know how to combine the description of this group as topological group with the study of higher ramification filtration on this group. High ramification filtration is a very arithmetical thing, and we don't know how to combine arithmetic with kind of algebraic topological information about this group. So this is a very open problem, and there are many interesting sub-problems in this direction. So of course, because I am giving these lectures in the World Center in Abelian geometry, then I have to say, of course, that Abelian geometry gives us additional insights about the absolute Galois groups in the following fashion that, like, if we know the absolute Galois group as a topological group, and suppose we have two global fields and their absolute Galois groups are isomorphic, then what can we deduce about the original global fields? So suppose we have two global fields, finite extensions of Q, and the absolute Galois group are isomorphic as topological groups. So this question was asked a long time ago, and the answer is known due to results by Neukirch, Iwasawa, Ikeda, and Uchida. And the point is that the fields then also are isomorphic. And there are even stronger statements and known properties. So this is just an Abelian geometry. I'm not talking here about mono-Abelian results, just classical Abelian geometry. But this is classical Abelian geometry for fields. So in fact, we have three Japanese mathematicians and one German mathematician. So this is for global fields. But for local fields, this collapses. For local fields, this is not true. If we have, if Q is replaced with QP, then not true in general. But still one can do something even in the local case. And so this is all very well known. So now I'll state the first exercise. If somebody can solve this first exercise, please pass your solutions to me. I'm addressing students only. If you can solve this exercise number one, please pass your solutions to me when you are ready. So this exercise is like this. Prove that every non-trivial closed Abelian subgroup of GQ and of GQP is isomorphic to Z hat as an additive group. So every non-trivial closed Abelian subgroup is isomorphic to Z hat. So for example, we cannot have closed Abelian subgroups which are Z hat times Z hat. So if you can solve this, I can even give a hint. Use cohomological dimension. And something.
So ZL is a non-trivial closed.
Ah, okay. Isomorphic to Z hat or Z L for some L.
Well, also Z L times Z L prime. So.
Ah, yes. Okay, so then I have to say procyclic. Okay, I have to say it is procyclic. Unfortunately, you are not interested in credits. So procyclic means that there is one generator which topologically generates a group. So this indeed includes cases like z hat or zl or zl times zl prime, zl double prime, where those are all different prime numbers and so on. But procyclic means that there is just one topological generator. So the closure of the group generated by that generator coincides with that closed subgroup. So anyway, this is just still talking about Kummer theory and what can we do if we want to to replace it with something else. Those results from an abelian geometry actually use class field theory. I now switch to class field theory. So class field theory is kind of the first known arithmetical theory which extends Kummer theory and works over arithmetic fields. So it does not need too many torsions, too many roots of unity in the ground field. So class field theory. And so I will abbreviate it as CFT. CFT is also used as abbreviation for conformal field theory in quantum physics, but here it will be in the arithmetic context. CFT. So it's a long history, but typical names which typically mentioned are start with German mathematicians like Kronecker, Weber, Hilbert. So all German mathematicians. And then Furtwängler, but then a Japanese mathematician, Takagi. And then again, German mathematicians, Artin, Hasse. That was time when Göttingen and Germany overall was the strongest country in algebraic number theory in the world. And so many other people. So typically, when you study class field theory, if you study it, you study a homological approach, which appeared even later. So I will discuss it soon. But right now, I would like just to emphasize a very substantial thing, which you cannot find in any textbook on class field theory. Well, at least in explicit form. The substantial thing is that there are two fundamentally different types of class field theory. And the first is CFT, so this is special class field theory. And the second type is GCFT, and this is general class field theory. So the distinction between these two theories is very clear when you start with the original theories. So special theories are those which use torsion elements or division points, torsion elements, division points, and values of functions, of some functions, values of functions at such elements. And so originally, cyclotomic theory and CM theory were special theories. Cyclotomic, which is related to Kummer theory, but not that one which I described, but another. Kummer work for cyclotomic field, cyclotomic theory and then CM theory, complex multiplication theory. So these were special types of class field theory. They really use these elements, and these series are not easy. So even cyclotomic series, there are various textbooks which contain mistakes, even in the cyclotomic theory. As for complex multiplication theory, then Weber published like 6 or 7 editions of his book on algebra in 3 volumes. Each of the editions contained mistakes in cyclotomic theory related to the two primary parts. So there is a paper of Schapacher which discusses those mistakes. And also Hilbert apparently wasn't really understanding what he wants when he stated one of his problems, namely Hilbert problem 12, which was asking generalize this class field series to work, to make them work over any number field. So cyclotomic works only over Q, and CM works over quadratic, imaginary quadratic extensions over Q. So Hilbert asked if there is any class field theory, or more precisely, he asked to get such class field theory which works over any number field. And we still don't have such theory. In fact, such theory apparently does not exist. The best approximation to answering Hilbert's question was obtained by Japanese mathematician Shimura, who used, who developed analog of CM theory for abelian varieties. But it only works over certain small number fields, and it does not work over arbitrary fields. So special theories work over some specific fields, not over all. And general class field theory works over any field. So general class field theory, unlike special class field theory, work over all fields. And from conceptual point of view, there are fundamental differences between these two types of class field theories. So the first example of some part of general class field theory comes from the work of Takagi, which was his existence theorem. So he proved, I will discuss existence theorem later. He proved so-called existence theorem for all number fields. So this was the first example of general class field theory. So conceptually, it was completely different from the special class field theory. So it was a genuine breakthrough. And also, it's well known that he was working alone during the First World War in Japan, so he was able to publish his results only in 1920, but he probably produced them during the war. So that was the first example of general class field theory almost 100 years ago in Tokyo, produced in Tokyo, not far from here. And just to emphasize how conceptually essential was this breakthrough, I can mention, and I'll discuss it later in my lectures, that we still don't fully recognize the value of Takagi's work, but more generally, general class field theory. So for example, in the Langlands program, we still don't have any analog of general class field theory. We have analog of special class field theory in the Langlands program, but not of general class field theory. So in other words, in the Langlands program, we are still waiting for new Takagi, maybe again from Tokyo or maybe from Kyoto, who will come and propose fundamentally different development from the Langlands program, which works over arbitrary number fields. Currently, we don't have such developments. So it's amazing that 100 years ago, and still we don't fully understand, because we don't have analog of it in the Langlands program. So I'll discuss this a little later. Now, for general class field theory, here it's just cyclotomic, CM, Shimura, but for general class field theory, of course, the list will be very long. And I only mention that as happens not once with some very important work, it causes difficulties for its contemporaries to understand it and digest. So I suspect that Artin and Hasse did not really understand Takagi's work, but they developed their own general class field theory. Artin developed his own general class field theory. And in particular, Artin reciprocity map. Artin reciprocity map, well, Artin reciprocity map, of course, was first derived by Artin. And there was a fundamental mistake in the first version of his work. He assumed some property, which is now called Chebotarev density theorem property. So he assumed that it holds, but its proof still was not known. It was actually obtained by Chebotarev independently of Artin And Chebotarev was a Russian mathematician working in Kiev. So here I would like to state the next exercise. And the next exercise is of historical nature. So reciprocity map and used... there are many ways to spell the name of Chebotarev, but the English standard name is like this. English standard way to spell the name of Chebotarev is like this. So the story is that Chebotarev proved his theorem, and he decided to come to the center of algebraic number theory, Göttingen, to give a talk about his proof at Hilbert seminar. But Hilbert had a secretary, a mathematician called Ostrovsky. And Chebotarev came to the secretary of Hilbert and asked him if he can give a talk at Hilbert's seminar. But the secretary of Hilbert, Ostrovsky, decided that Chebotarev behaves suspiciously, and maybe he's not even a mathematician, but he wants to give a talk, but maybe he's not a mathematician. So he decided to test Chebotarev. So this is a test. Are you allowed to meet with Hilbert or not? This will be exercise number two. So everyone can check if you are allowed to meet with Hilbert or not. So he gave him a problem, and he said he could not solve it already for 2 weeks. Chebotarev solved it and came with solution the next morning. And then, of course, Ostrovsky allowed Chebotarev to meet with Hilbert. And then Artin learned from Hilbert about Chebotarev's density theorem and then corrected his paper on class field theory. And then this is how class field theory in the style of Artin appeared. So here I'll then state exercise number two. So this is to test if you can meet with Hilbert or not. The statement is elementary. So let's form a matrix, M capital, which I'll also write like MIJ, where I is from 1 to P, and J is from 1 to P. And P is prime number. So a matrix of order P times P with entries MIJ. And the entry MIJ is the following. Just choose a primitive piece root of unity, for example, well, anyway, a primitive piece root of unity, a complex number. A primitive piece root of unity. Fix it. And then MIJ is just this piece root of unity raised to the power of I plus J. So this matrix is called like Vandermonde matrix or something. I don't remember. So it's just powers of zeta p. So for example, it will be like zeta p squared, 1 plus 1 zeta p cube, zeta p cube, zeta p to the power of 4, and so on. So order p times p. Then let's take any number r between 1 and p. And then choose r rows and r columns. So choose arbitrary r rows and r columns of this matrix M. And select elements which stand at the intersection of R rows and R columns. So this will be a matrix of order R times R. So the problem which Ostrovsky asked Chebotarev to solve is prove that its determinant is not zero. Prove that this matrix is not singular. In other words, its determinant is not zero. So it's an invertible matrix. So, of course, if you apply this to I equals to 1, then it's obvious. And if you apply R equals to P, then this is, again, Vandermonde determinant or something like this. It's also obvious that the determinant is non-zero. The problem is what happens when R is between one, strictly between 1 and P, and especially when you choose not one rows which are next to each other, but in arbitrary way. So again, I can give a hint. The statement is completely elementary, like first year calculus. But the hint is that, in fact, the shortest possible solution uses the fact that piece root of unity minus 1, so use the fact that piece root of unity minus 1 is a prime element of the cyclotomic field QP edit piece root of unity. So if you use this fact, of course, if you are a number theorist, algebraic number theorist, you know this fact, of course. Chebotaryov knew it, of course. So if you use this fact, then it's possible to solve this problem, elementary-looking problem, very fast. Otherwise, maybe it's not so easy. So approximately 30 years ago, I gave this problem to undergraduate students attending my seminar on algebraic number theory in St. Petersburg. And one student solved this problem, a girl from second undergraduate year. So she is now professor in University of Stockholm in Sweden. But anyway, if you manage to solve this problem, good. It's partially a joke, but the problem is real and the solution is real. And it's amazing that to solve such elementary stated problem, it's better to know some number theory. So now, coming back to class field theory, coming back to class field theory, so of course, Artin and then Haas started to use the Brouwer group. So this was the first time when the Brouwer group was intensively used for class field theory purposes. And then Chevalier introduced Idels. And then Haas also introduced local global principle and also local class field theory. So before this, there was no local class field theory, only global. Haas was the first to start to develop local class field theory together with global. And after the introduction of Idels, class field theory exposition switched to first construct the local theory and then the global. And then after the war, there was a cohomological approach. And there were many cohomological approaches, and there are hundreds of papers, maybe more than 300 of papers on cohomological class field theory just for number fields and local fields. And there is, of course, a very famous book by Artin and Tate, which is really very nicely written by Tate. But the seminar was by Artin. So this cohomological approach, unfortunately, eventually suppressed all other approaches. To essential degree. In many countries, people were studying, including Soviet Union or Russia, studying class field theory just directly starting with cohomological approach. But many important features of class field theory are hidden in cohomological approach. And for example, Haas was very unhappy that so many beautiful, as he was saying, flexible things from the beautiful edifice of class field theory were completely forgotten because of the penetration, as he was saying, of cohomological methods in number theory. He was very unhappy, despite the fact that he worked with the Brouwer group, which, of course, has a very simple cohomological interpretation. So I will talk a little more about cohomological, what is bad about cohomological approach. I will talk a little. The main bad feature is that it's not explicit. If you want to do concrete computations, it's very difficult to use cohomological approach. You want explicit approaches. And so explicit approach came from the work of several people like Tate, Dvorak. It's called also Dvorak lemma sometimes, but it was proved by Tate. Tate, Dvorak, Hasewinkel, and then Neukirch. The same Neukirch has in Annabelin results for global fields. And so this was explicit class field theory. This explicit class field theory can be applied to many problems because you can easily compute the image of an element with respect to the reciprocity map. So this is much more powerful theory. And also it is explicit and it is general. So this was long historical process. This is already like late 90s or maybe 1980s, maybe already even 1980s. So you see it's a really long historical process. And when these people were trying to simplify, they did not meet much support from the community because usually you want to hear about new results. So what is the point to simplify something? Anyway, everyone believes that class field theory is correct, even though almost no one really understands class field theory. But everyone believes it's correct. So what is the point to really to simplify what is believed to be correct anyway? But now we understand that there were many points very important why we needed this simplification, in particular because of further developments in higher class field theory. But not only that. So I will talk about this later. What I would like to emphasize right now, that then we came to very paradoxical situation. Originally, class field theory started with special class field theory. And then we had general class field theory, which was really difficult at the beginning. Very few people could understand general class field theory. For example, this cohomological method, Art and Tate book, is like the beginning of 1950s. But like in 1950s, in all of Russia, there was only one mathematician who understood class field theory, Shafarevich. Nobody else could understand it. So everyone who wanted to learn class field theory had to go to Moscow to meet Shafarevich and ask him to explain class field theory. Well, like these days, maybe everyone who wants to study IUT has to come to Kyoto. But the point is that at that time, the theory was really very difficult. You know, Russian mathematics was very strong. Many excellent mathematicians, for example, Gelfand. So Gelfand did not understand class field theory. Arnold and many Kolmogorov, they did not understand. There was only one, Shafarevich, who understood class field theory. So it was very difficult. But then it was simplified, 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 and eventually this simplified, explicit, general class field theory became simpler than special class field theory. So we have a paradoxical situation like this explicit general class field theory works over any field. So it's more powerful, it's functorial. And it is simpler than special class field theory, which work only over some fields. So then you can ask, what is the point to have this special class field series if we have general explicit class field theory, which is simpler than this, and also work over all fields, and this works only over some special fields. But still, we, of course, use special class field theory because many people like very concrete computations, and if they are not told what specific field extension plays fundamental role in some theory, then they even don't study that theory. In general class field theory, of course, there are no specific field extensions which of Q, for example, which play fundamental role because it works over any number field. So it's a paradoxical situation. And so we'll see what happens, because this explicit class field theory is still not very well known. And I will describe some features of it. Even though there are two Springer volumes, authored by Neukirch, which contain a lot of details of this theory. Right, so... Yes?
Perhaps I'm misunderstanding
yes?
something, but it seems that if you take the first two rows and the first two columns of the matrix,
no, it's not.
It seems that it's CP to the sixth power minus CP.
Six minus. Ah, it seems, yes. It seems. Ah. Yeah. I gave you a wrong problem. You could have tried and tried and tried, and already be very disappointed that you will never meet with Gilbert. Ah, okay, I will check and give you correct problem next time. But yeah, it's very strange, isn't it? Yeah, something wrong with my problems today. Okay, so I will give you correct version of this problem on, but there is a correct version, and it was solved by a second year undergraduate student 30 years ago in St. Petersburg. I will give you a correct version on Friday. There is also, but I will tell about this later. Yes, it's something, yeah, I won't spend time now to correct. I will tell it on Friday. So there is also class field theory in positive characteristic, and there I will talk about it a little later. Yes, and just to finish this discussion of evolution of general class field theory, what is important to emphasize that explicit class field theory does not use the Brouwer group. It does not use the Brouwer group. So the Brouwer group, of course, was used by Hasse, and then H2 cohomological approach. So class field theory from cohomological point of view is H2 theory. It's, of course, closely related to the Brouwer group. But explicit class field theory does not use the Brouwer group. And the fact that you can have class field theory without computations with the Brouwer group still remains not very widely known. So now let's go to the issue of what really class field theory is. Well, at least to some aspects of this issue. And so CFT has four parts. So traditionally, often people believe that it's only the first part which is important, but and which is class field theory. But in fact, there are four parts. Okay. So the first part is functorial reciprocity map. So this is from some Galois module, like we can denote it CK, to the absolute Galois group, to the maximum abelian quotient of the absolute Galois group of K. And this CK, as it is very well known, equals to either the multiplicative group of a local field or to the ideal class group of a global field. So this reciprocity map, it is almost an isomorphism, but not exactly, but almost an isomorphism. And also because it's functorial construction, then unlike special class field theories, here just for free you get various other properties, like if you have finite extension of fields, L over K, then the quotient of this by the norm subgroup corresponding to the finite extension is isomorphic to the maximal abelian quotient of the Galois group of L over K, assuming that this is finite Galois extension. So this just easily follows from functoriality. So on this functorial reciprocity map, there are many, many, many papers, maybe several hundreds. And maybe at least 100 of them were written by Japanese mathematicians after the Second World War. So when I was a PhD student, I took my duty very seriously. In particular, I thought that if I study class field theory, I should read all papers ever published in class field theory. So I started with papers after the Second World War, and I think I read all papers which were published till approximately 1965. So from 1950, 1945 till 1965, I read all papers ever published in class field theory. And definitely more than half of them were papers produced by Japanese mathematicians. I remember that very clearly. So, because there are many versions and generalizations of class field theory and many questions, so it's not difficult to find some question which you want to answer. And usually it's not too difficult to answer such a question. So if we are interested in this functorial reciprocity map from cohomological point of view to compare with the Kummer map, which was once on this blackboard, then, so for example, local cohomological theory. So we work with local fields, and then we can consider the group of characters of the absolute Galois group with values in Z mod M and pair it with the quotient which we already see in the Kummer map. And then this also, as we already seen, is, well, we did not see it, but it's obvious. This is the same as this H1, and this via Kummer theory is the same as up to isomorphism as this one. So there is subtle difference, Z mod M and mu M. I don't assume here that roots of unity are in the ground field. And then the key part, we take the cup product. So this is cup product. And then we land in H2 of GK. Then the product of those two give us mu M. So this is exactly the M part of the Brouwer group of K. This is for local fields. And it is isomorphic to Z mod M. Is if M is prime to characteristic of K. So, and from, so then from this pairing, one immediately gets a pairing from here to the dual group of this. And so this immediately gives a pairing, a homomorphism from the multiplicative group to the absolute Galois group of AB because of this. More precisely, mod M, and here also mod M. So this will be part of the reciprocity map, and then you tend M to infinity. So this is a very simple, but the problem is the cup product. Cup product is not explicit. Cup product is not explicit. If you want to do concrete computations with the reciprocity map, then it, because the cup product is not explicit, it's really very difficult. And instead of all this in this explicit class field theory, the reciprocity map will be defined directly without using cohomology groups. But from the point of view of the objects involved, class field theory looks like closely related to Kummer theory, but just a little more complicated. And it looks like H2 theory. It is H2 theory because you have to use H2. So it's like the next step from the Kummer theory, in some sense, for arithmetic fields. This is just for local fields. Right, so there were various associated developments in class field theory, and in particular, one of them is related to so-called class formations. And so this class formation started with the book of Artin and Tate, and then again, there are really many papers on class formations. So this is, in some sense, important conception, philosophically point. So it's called class formations in class field theory. And so these class formations are basically an attempt to understand class field theory better. And Well, as Laurent Laforgue says, and I completely agree with him, understanding is much more important than proofs in mathematics. So we really want to understand what class field theory is about. And one way to understand class field theory is like set a, such a problem. So what is the minimal number of axioms from which you can derive class field theory? So can you set some small number of axioms? And so if you know that a field satisfies those axioms, then you get reciprocity map, like in class field theory. So typically, these axioms are about H0 and H1. So some property for H0, the index of the norm group, and the property for H1 is Hilbert theorem 90, which is general property for all fields. And from this, you basically want to deduce reciprocity map. And saying that this kind of helps you to understand class field theory. So already Artin and Tate did something like this, and then there were many, many other people who were interested in this activity. I'm mentioning this because now, just recently, just 2 years ago, or maybe earlier, but at least for me it was 2 years ago, we finally understood what was going on in all these activities about class formations and class field theory. So on one hand, you can say people were genuinely trying to understand class field theory like this. But from the point of view of Abelian geometry, we can say that what is going on is that we want to separate parts of class field theory which depend on group structure only from parts of class field theory which depend on ring structure, which use ring structure. So we want to separate what is dependent in class field theory only on group structure, on groups, on topological groups and Galois modules, group structure, from what in class field theory depends not just on groups, but on ring structure, so on two operations. So, and it appears that exactly this mechanism, which produces reciprocity map from these axioms, it can be, if necessary, restated, but it only uses group structure. So this implication, this arrow, it uses only group structure. It does not use ring structure. Whereas checking these axioms about H0 and H1 for specific fields like global fields or local fields, it uses ring structure. And more precisely, computation of the norm, of the index of the norm group uses ring structure. So we can check only this axiom if we use the fact that we deal with rings. So we have a kind of separation of the theory into two parts. And so, of course, the use of group structure is very nice for Abelian geometry considerations. But inevitably, we also have to use ring structure. But at least we know that it's only at the beginning to check these axioms. The rest is purely group theoretical mechanism. So this is just a very recent development. So now I will briefly present Neuker's explicit class field theory because it's so simple, it's easy to describe. Am I supposed to make a break? Okay. Because, you know, I can talk even for 5 hours if you want without break, but maybe this would be too much. Right, so let's discuss explicit class field theory in a little more detail. So this is Neuker's approach. So I already mentioned that Neuker worked in Abelian geometry for number fields. And I never discussed that directly with him, but I feel like his approach to class field theory was influenced by his previous work in Abelian geometry. But unfortunately, it is impossible already to confirm or disconfirm this. So the key aspect, the key feature which is used in explicit class field theory is surjective homomorphism from the absolute Galois group of a field for which we want to have class field theory to Z hat. So we just need surjective homomorphism from the absolute Galois group to that head. If we have such surjective homomorphism, then provided some other properties are satisfied, we can construct a class field theory. So, of course, if K is local, then this head, that head corresponds to the Galois group of the maximal unramified extension of K. The Galois group of the maximal unramified extension of a local field is, of course, that head. So the question is, what happens if K is global? So if K is global, then where do we get this that head? We get it from the following construction. We start with Q. Then we consider the maximal cyclotomic extension of Q. So this maximal cyclotomic extension of Q over Q has Galois group, which is that head multiplicative. And this group that head multiplicative is then the product of all that P multiplicative. And each that P multiplicative has that P times something, which is something finite, which is not difficult to identify. And so in particular, we have then a canonical subgroup here, which is just the product of all that P, which is that head. We also have a canonical that head quotient of this group just by dividing by the torsion. And so the product of the torsion. And so this gives us a sub-extension Q tilde inside the maximal cyclotomic extension such that this group is, the Galois group is Z-hat. So this is exactly the Z-hat extension which replaces the maximal unramified extension for local fields, and which is used in explicit class field theory. So for arbitrary number field, you just take composite of this Q tilde with finite extension of Q. So it's interesting. Of course, the maximal unramified extension of local field also is cyclotomic, but just roots of order, all roots of order prime to P. Not all roots, but all roots of order prime to P. Whereas here we work with this sub-extension, which is inside the cyclotomic extension, but its relation with all roots is a little non-trivial. So it's not generated by roots, some roots of unity. The relation is more non-trivial. So anyway, this is a Z-hat quotient, but this theory works for arbitrary field which has some Z-hat quotient satisfying additional properties. So in both cases, I denote this extension like Q tilde, and here the maximum unramified extension. So for arbitrary field, I will then view this as the Galois group of some K tilde over K. And then, what is the use of Z-hat extension? It is procyclic group, infinite free procyclic group generated by something which is typically called Frobenius. Even though here, of course, we already do not have Frobenius in the usual sense, but still, from the point of view of class field theory, it plays the role of Frobenius. So in particular, if we have, say, if we consider this diagram, so this extension is Z-hat. This is finite Galois extension. And say here we have some Galois automorphism sigma. And here Z-hat is, say, generated by phi, topologically, which is like Frobenius, so it's generalization. So we have this picture, and this L tilde is just the composite of L and K tilde. Suppose that these are linearly disjoint extensions. Suppose they are linearly disjoint. So in the local case, this is totally ramified extension. So then we can consider the fixed field with respect to the product of sigma and phi. We can lift phi at this level, I denote it by the same notation, and then we can consider the fixed field of the product of sigma and phi. So this will be sigma. It will be, again, a finite extension of K. It will be, if sigma is non-trivial, it will be different from L. And this extension, again, will have Galois group Z hat. So this group, Galois group, is, again, Z hat, and it is generated by this generator, sigma phi. So it's a subtle play with Frobenius, an element of infinite order, and then its product with Galois elements of finite order. And because of the properties of the group Z hat, each time when we consider fixed fields, we get a finite extension such that this is still a Z hat extension. And moreover, a remarkable observation by Neukirch is that not only this diagram makes sense, but one interesting fact is that this field then also is nothing else than sigma tilde. So in other words, this field is the same as sigma composed with K tilde. So there is this interesting relation that actually this is like in the local case, this is the maximal unramified extension, but then this field will be the maximal unramified extension of this fixed field. So this property is used to construct class field theory. Because then in this specific situation, reciprocity map, if we look at it from the reverse point of view, so we want to know the image of Galois automorphism, then sigma with respect to reciprocity map should go to the norm from sigma capital down to K of some prime element, any prime element of the field sigma capital. In the local case, what prime element should be clear. In the global case, it can be defined. Modulo the norm group. And this will be exactly the reciprocity map. And moreover, it is defined very explicitly. So a more general So if you think more and more about this picture, then you want to understand what is really going on here. And another way to say what's going on here is that for unramified extensions, the basic principle of class field theory tells that Frobenius goes to prime element. But what to do with totally ramified extensions? So this is the key part of class field theory. But the point is that if you have a totally ramified Galois extension, you can always make a finite base change such that the new extension becomes unramified. So you can pass from any extension essentially to unramified extensions. And because for unramified extensions, you know class field theory, which is basically a theory for finite fields, then automatically, if you use functoriality of class field theory, you know also class field theory for ramified extensions, because after finite base change, you can make them unramified, where you know how the reciprocity map should behave. And so this is exactly reflected in this. So here, this element sigma phi should correspond to pi sigma, because this extension is unramified. But then functoriality just tells us if we want to descend from this level to this level, we just apply the norm map. So it's very, very simple idea, and it works. And it works not only locally, but globally, where you need specifically to define what a prime element is as an element of a Del class group. But this can be done. On the other hand, it's remarkable that to achieve all this, you work with arbitrary prime element. So you allow a certain degree of indeterminacy here. You like relax the whole situation, you make it less rigid. Here it's just arbitrary prime element, and there is no specific choice of prime element which you can include in this theory. It's just any prime element. But the point is that the answer doesn't depend on the choice of prime element, because you then take everything modulo the norm group. But by allowing to work with arbitrary prime element, you get more flexibility in the theory. And then, for example, if you want to prove that this is a homomorphism, which is not obvious, if you want to prove that this is a homomorphism, you need to do some work. But because you allow arbitrary prime elements, then this work is not very cumbersome. So anyway, so this is the main idea of explicit class field theory. As you see, it does not use any cohomologies, and it's very, very explicit. It tells you exactly what the image of Galois automorphism is in the co-kernel of the norm map. And amazingly, it works not only for local fields, but also for global. And even more amazingly, it also works for higher local fields, global fields, and so on. So this idea to consider quotients of the absolute Galois group and not to go to the maximal abelian quotient of the absolute Galois group, but to stay at the level of the full absolute Galois group and consider its topological quotients which are isomorphic to that head, it's very interesting. It's important to work with the minimal reasonable infinite subquotient like that head, and then the property that it, that head is essentially used in this picture. And then things remarkably get simplified. So it's also interesting that, you know, this is class field theory for finite Galois extensions. But the easiest presentation of this class field theory for finite Galois extensions comes when you allow infinite extensions, like Z-hat extensions. So a priori, it's not obvious at all why should you start to involve infinite extensions if you want only class field theory for finite extensions. But so far, this is the simplest possible approach to class field theory that we know. In positive characteristic, we know some simpler approaches, but I don't discuss them here. So I would like to emphasize that this is the most applied part of class field theory, because here you can do any computations you need. And I'm receiving like every year some questions from all places in the world to help with some computations of the reciprocity map. So using this description, it's really much easier to do computations. Cohomological approach completely hopeless, very difficult to apply. But this approach is very applicable. Now, while we are here, I also would like to mention some other related theory by Neuker, which was his last paper. He died at age of very young age, like 58. So this is microprimes, his theory of microprimes. So I think this paper is almost forgotten. So this is again Neuker. And I think this paper, if one really tries to understand this paper on microprimes, it may lead to some new developments in unabelian geometry of local fields. So I'll just, and global fields. So it's definitely not in completed form. It can be improved. I know some ways to improve it, but I never thought about it seriously, but this is interesting. So what is microprime? I don't like the word microprime, but there is alternative word which is virtual prime, virtual primes. So virtual primes. And these virtual primes will be Galois automorphisms. This will be not elements of number fields, they will be Galois automorphisms. So this is an attempt to get part of class field theory at the level of Galois groups. So certain Galois automorphisms will be called virtual primes, and they will kind of play the role of, they will have properties similar to primes of Dedekind rings. So again, in this theory, one starts with this surjective homomorphism. So we can start with any topological group, profinite, for example, and suppose there is a surjective homomorphism from this group to that head. Like, for example, here, similar surjective homomorphism plays a fundamental role. But this is even does not need to be related to any fields, just arbitrary group, and let's denote this, it's like degree homomorphism, so let's denote it by D. And its kernel, let's denote by I. So its kernel is kind of analog of inertia group in some generalized sense. And again, for local and global fields, I described already how to choose such Z-hat extensions. So now, for every closed subgroup H of G, suppose that the index of H, of the image of H with respect to D, is finite. So if this index is finite, then define modified degree map, well, in the most natural way, like this. So it will be again a surjective. And then an element phi of H is called a generic Frobenius Frobenius automorphism or generic Frobenius if it is sent to 1 by DH. So it's like analogous and compatible with the previous theory. So let's now introduce the set of all Frobenius, not only generic, but Frobenius automorphisms denoted FRH, which by definition consists of all elements of the group H, such that DH of phi is a natural number. Natural number starts with 1. In Japan, do natural numbers include 0?
When constrained log structures,
it includes 0. I guess in France they also include 0, but in other countries like Russia and Germany, they do not include 0. So, so the main observation is that the topological group generated by phi can be thought of as virtual. In a certain sense, is virtual decomposition group of a virtual prime. So virtual means like not in the usual sense, but in some refined sense. And so these groups can be viewed as analog of decomposition groups, just of usual primes. So this is just the usual standard classical decomposition group of usual primes of global fields. But here we work with arbitrary group. So the key point is that we need some degree map values in that head, and then we look at those elements on which the degree takes natural values starting with 1. So then, what are some basic properties of this group? So for example, one of first properties is that if the index of the image of H is finite, then this set, a subset of the group H, is dense in H. So this virtual, well, this the phi is called Frobenius, not generic, but Frobenius, because the value not necessarily 1, but a natural number greater than or equal than 1. So this Frobenius, the set of Frobenius elements, Galois automorphism, is dense in the Galois in the group H. And if this index is infinity, then the set of Frobeniuses is just empty. So then I'm trying to define what is a virtual prime or micro prime. And then as typical in also in algebraic number theory and in many other places, we need to take into account conjugation action. So let's now define for a closed subgroup H of G, let's define the natural action of H times natural numbers on the set FRG. And the action is very simple. Take sigma, take n, and then it sends phi to sigma, phi to the power of n sigma inverse. So conjugation and also raising to natural power n. Okay, so then a definition. A micro prime or a virtual prime of H, a micro prime, of H, by definition, is the closure of the topological closure of the orbit of with respect to the action of H times n of phi, where phi is a Frobenius Galois automorphism. And so this is a micro prime P of H is the closure of this orbit of phi in FRG. So these are some subsets of Frobenius Galois automorphisms, which take into account conjugation and also some action, which of course shows up in many other places as well. So this is just Neukirch's definition, what a microprime is. And the main result of his theory, which was the content of his last paper, was that these microprimes have amazingly similar properties to usual primes of Dedekind rings. So maybe I'll just state a couple of his results. So all proofs are completely elementary. So basically, they show that a lot of algebraic number theory is again of group theoretical nature. So for example, we can define decomposition groups of microprimes. And so suppose we have G and then closed subgroup H and then normal subgroup, say H1. And suppose we have a microprime P of H1. So P is a microprime of H1. So this definition is microprime for any closed subgroup of G. So then the decomposition group GP by definition of H and H1. So by definition, this consists of all elements sigma in H mod H1, such that when they act by conjugation on this subset corresponding to microprimes, they give us back the same subset. So in other words, this is also the normalizer in the quotient of H by H1 of this equivalence class corresponding to the microprime P. And then in particular, if we consider such decomposition group when the second group is trivial, then this is called the generalisation of H. Of H at P. And it's defined up to conjugation. So if G is the Galois group or the absolute Galois group of some field, then the fixed field of this subgroup will correspond to the generalization of the original ground field. And so this Hinzelization has many properties similar to the usual Hinzelization in algebraic number theory. So in the case when the ground field is a local field or a global field, because of that property which was exercise number one, that every closed abelian non-trivial subgroup is procyclic, we don't need to, we can remove the closure in the definition of microprime. So it will be just the orbit. So this can be removed if G is the absolute Galois group of a local field or global field because of exercise one. So then the theory simplifies and many more results can be obtained. But for example, it still remains unknown whether the theory of microprimes can be extended to other fields for which we have class field theory, for example, to higher fields. And so from my point of view, something is going on in this theory which has explicit unabelian flavor. And on the other hand, I have not seen any papers in unabelian geometry which explicitly deal with these issues. So it's just like a small advertisement for the last paper of Neukirch, which was on microprimes. So it was kind of, it on one hand, related in some sense to explicit class field theory, because for microprimes, he also constructed class field theory, which is class field theory for microprimes. So it's related to class field theory. On the other hand, it's related a little to unabelian geometry. And I believe, actually, it should have very interesting connections with unabelian geometry, but no unabelian geometer, to the best of my knowledge, so far has tried to understand such relations. Okay, so now this was a small additional information about microprimes, which is not exactly class field theory, but I'm concentrating on class field theory. And now I just wanted to discuss something related to characteristic P, another treasure in class field theory, which is almost forgotten. And it came from two Japanese mathematicians, Kawada and Sataki. So let's have a look at class field theory in positive characteristic. So P is positive. So first of all, there is no Kummer theory for P torsion in characteristic P, because there are no non-trivial piece roots of unity in characteristic P. But on the other hand, there is Weil theory. And if you use Weil theory, which is actually even simpler than Kummer theory, then you get almost momentarily the P primary part of class field theory in positive characteristic. So this was an observation which was made probably by many people, but at least in published form, it is a paper of Kawada Sataki somewhere like 1962. So it is already like more than 55 years old. And that paper was almost completely forgotten. So in particular, it was forgotten, well, maybe forgotten, maybe not, I don't know. But anyway, the main substance is, so let's call it Kawada-Sataki method. And the main point is that, main principle is that the P primary part of class field theory in characteristic P is very easy if you use Kawada-Sataki method. If you use cohomological methods, it's very easy to make it extremely difficult. Very easy to make it extremely difficult. But if you use Kawada-Sataki method, then the theory becomes very easy and actually very natural. And I will just try to describe very fast some features of this theory, because this is maybe the most powerful part in class field theory, which is so easy and which works universally. In the original method, they did it for local and global fields, but then now we know it works for higher local, higher global fields. And basically, I think it works for any class field theory, which will be derived in the future. And the P primary part is always the most difficult part of class field theory in characteristic P. The rest is just linear algebra. So the fact that the P primary part of class field theory in characteristic P can be made very easy is very important, because you can ignore other approaches which sometimes become very, very difficult. Right, so here we have to use Weil theory. And Weil theory is closely related to Kummer theory, but different. So Weil theory, of course, works with Weil vectors, or P primary Weil vectors. And so maybe I don't define what Weil vectors are. Do I need to define what Weil vectors are? Weil vectors. Anyone for Weil vectors definition? Does everyone know the definition? No? Okay, I'll define very fast. Or I'll tell something. So this is the Weil ring of field K of positive characteristic. And so Weil vectors are something like this. So these are vectors with infinitely many components. And so all the elements belong to K. But then you define, so this will be a ring. So you define addition and multiplication. But you define it in a kind of smart way. So you define it in a smart way using so-called Weil polynomials. And this is closely related to the following issue. So to understand what's going on here, you just ask one of the first natural questions when you study local fields. So I just don't want really to write formulas. I want to explain what's going on. So to explain what's going on, just suppose we have just the usual, for example, field of periodic numbers, QP. And then we have some element which is non-zero of QP. And suppose it's even in ZP. Or maybe it's just in the ring ZP. So then we can write it like this. We can write it like A naught plus A1P plus A2P square and so on. And we can have coefficients from a specific set. So we can have coefficients which belong to the set 0 and all roots of unity of order p minus 1. This is called multiplicative representation, and these are called Tuchmüller representatives. So the Tuchmüller name also shows up here. Tuchmüller representatives. So this is convenient because if you want Galois action, then it's easier to compute, if you go to arbitrary local fields. But the problem is then how do we compute the sum and the product? So suppose we have beta, which is in similar shape. So how do we compute the sum so that so the sum will be, again, something in this shape. And again, with coefficients from this set. So this is a little non-trivial problem. Because if you start computing just directly, you easily see that because this set is not closed with respect to addition, then you leave this set. But you want to have all coefficients in this set. So this means that you have to do some additional work. And the question is, what is the simplest way to get the answer? And basically, so of course, for the first coefficient, so obviously the first coefficient will be just congruent to A naught plus B naught mod P. So it's not, it's okay, but then if it is not equal but congruent, then you have to move something to coefficient of p, and when you compute c1, then c1 will be like a1 plus b1 plus maybe something like, if this is greater than p, then you should not forget that then c0 will be smaller than p, well, if it's root of unity. So something else. And so then you need to compute this something else. So this is almost elementary problem. It was solved by Witt, who noticed that if you just use Witt polynomials, this Witt polynomials is like x, and then, or maybe it's better to say x0, and then something like px0 plus x1 to the power of p, and then p square x0 plus px1p plus x2 to the power of p square, something like this. If you use the Witt polynomials, then actually you can explicitly give the answer what should be these coefficients in terms of applying Witt polynomials to the original coefficients. Another way to say this is like you have this Witt vector, but you can define it in characteristic zero. So-called ghost components, or you can define in any characteristic, ghost components of Witt vector. And at the level of, using Witt polynomials, and at the level of ghost components, it will be usual addition and multiplication. And then using again those Witt polynomials, you go back and you get the usual components, which give you the answer of the what is the sum and the product of two Witt vectors. So Witt vectors, basically, it's a model of what's going on at the level of local fields of mixed characteristic when you want to compute coefficients which are chosen in specific set like multiplicative representatives. So in particular, Witt vectors of FP, and this should not be a surprise, Witt vectors of FP is the same as ZP. And for any perfect field, K of positive characteristics, this will be just a mixed, it will be the ring of integers of local field F, where F is mixed characteristic local field with residue field K. So anyway, Witt vectors is just some formalism, but it's very convenient tool. And then Witt vectors used in Witt theory, which is very similar to Kummer theory. But in some sense, it is much more powerful because as a replacement of those pairings which I wrote for Kummer theory, Witt theory states the following. So suppose I denote by mk over k the maximal abelian extension of exponent p to the power of m. And then the Witt pairing is very similar to Kummer pairing. And it is a pairing between the Galois group of this abelian extension and the quotient of Witt vectors modulo some operator p, which is Frobenius minus 1. And this takes values in z mod p to the power of m. And by Witt theory, this is a continuous if you endow, well, you can endow Witt vectors with appropriate topologies, and this is a continuous and perfect pairing. So it's very similar to Kummer theory, but this time we don't need roots of unity, and we can reach any p abelian extension by increasing m. So it's Without roots of unity, piece roots of unity, but we can do basically everything, which is the great feature of characteristic P. And so in particular, the Galois group of this extension is isomorphic to the dual group of with vectors. Truncated with vectors modulo, these are truncated with vectors with just with the first M components modulo the image of the separator. And then as the analog of Kummer series, there is one-to-one correspondence between certain subgroups in with vectors which contain this and abelian extensions of exponent dividing P to the power of M. So this is classical with theory. And now, how is this used in Kawada-Sataki method? And in classical theory in characteristic P. So approximately, or maybe even more than approximately, so I will illustrate it in the local case. So suppose that K is a local field of characteristic P. So it's isomorphic to something like formal power series of what FQ or finite field of Q elements in one variable. And so when you deal with Gauss components, it's good to have lifts to from positive characteristic to characteristic zero. So I'll denote by O0 the width ring for FQ. And then we have surjective homomorphism, which is the residue map, down to FQ. And then this give us also surjective homomorphism from formal power series of O0 to K, which just sends every coefficient to element in the width ring of FQ to the corresponding element in FQ, and sends sums and products and continuous expressions of them in a similar way, T goes to T. So we have kind of lift from positive characteristic to characteristic zero, because this is an object in characteristic zero. This is useful when you compute Gauss components. So then we have very important Artin-Schreier with pairing. Which is the pairing of the quotient of the multiplicative group of the local field of characteristic P modulo such powers with width vectors of length R and with coefficients in width vectors over FP, which is the same as Z modulo P to the power of R. And so the definition is that A and B goes to the trace from FQ to FP. Of certain width vector C. And this vector C will be a width vector over FQ. And so the trace is the trace from width vectors over FQ to width vectors over FP. And what is C? So to define a width vector, it's sufficient to define its so-called Gauss components and then apply width polynomials. So Gauss component, the i-th Gauss component of C by definition is the residue with respect to T. So maybe I'll put it here. Or if you wish, residue, because it's coefficient of T inverse. It's the residue of the i-th component of the vector corresponding to, I will tell in a moment what, bi, and then times this. So this is like D-log, but they all underlined. So I need only to explain what is the meaning of the underlying. The meaning of underlying is related to this surjective homomorphism. So for example, A is in, well, we can view A as a lift, so as an element of K, and then so here I should write A, and also here I should write A. So so A bar is just any lift in this object of characteristic zero, which corresponds, which goes projected to A. Just any lift. And similarly for B. B is a vit vector here, and we take vit vectors in this ring, because we have surjective homomorphism, we can always lift. And then this is the ice ghost component of the lift of the vit vector B. So it takes a little time to explain, but actually this is very, very simple formula. You know, it uses the most elementary things which are known to us, the trace, the residue, and then just Dlog and vit vectors, and they are ghost components. So this Artin-Schreier vit pairing so explicit that it's very easy to prove its various properties. So in particular, the properties of this Artin-Schreier vit pairing include that it is, again, continuous and perfect. Continuous and perfect. And therefore, it's because it's a perfect pairing, it gives a duality which is called well, Artin-Schreier vit duality. And in particular, it shows that this group is isomorphic to the dual group of this. And this group is isomorphic to the dual group of this. But because of vit theory, like this, we know that vit vectors also dual to the Galois group. So the upshot is that this group, well, I need to factorize here by P. So the upshot is that this group is isomorphic to the group of characters of this group, and the group of characters of this group is isomorphic to the corresponding Galois group. So the upshot is that just elementary properties of this Artin-Schreier vit pairing immediately imply the homomorphism from this to the Galois group of the maximal abelian extension of K of exponent P to the power of R. And then tending R to plus infinity, of course, we'll get part of the reciprocity map. We'll get the P primary part of the reciprocity map. So this will be the P part, so this will be to the maximal P abelian extension of K. So this is the most, it's not injective because we need to factorize by the intersection of all these subgroups, but the point is that we get the most difficult part of the reciprocity map, which is the P primary part of the reciprocity map, almost for free, just from vit theory and from Artin-Schreier vit pairing. So this was known a long time ago, probably even before the Second World War, to German mathematicians. But what Kawada and Sataki did, they also extended it to work over global fields, where you replace, of course, these objects by del class groups. And exactly the same pairing, but only for global objects, again gives the reciprocity map of global reciprocity map the P primary part. So from this point of view, this is a very, very nice and almost elementary approach to class field theory. All other parts, prime to P, this is just linear algebra, so it's not so interesting even to discuss. But here, some very serious arithmetic is hidden, or maybe not so hidden. Another important feature, which I'll mention later, is that a generalization of this Artin-Schreier vit pairing easily give us higher class field series, P primary part of higher class field series and characteristic P. So again, today in my lecture, one of the main central topics is that we have Kummer map, linear algebra. And then from Kummer map, we go in different directions, for example, to Witt theory and Artin-Schreier. And then we have application to class field theory. Or we go from the Kummer map to cohomological approach to class field theory, and then we get the reciprocity map. So I was talking about four parts of class field theory, and you see I'm still talking about the first part. I even did not tell you the second, the third, and the fourth part. So maybe now is a good time if I tell you about the other three parts. So the second part is, of course, existence theory, which was proved by Takagi. And this existence theorem is some activity really different from getting the reciprocity map. It's a different activity. So one cannot say that class field theory is reduced just to reciprocity map, because, for example, existence theory is different kind of activity. Especially if you go from classical fields to some more interesting fields, like local fields with infinite perfect residue field, there we have existence theorem, which becomes quite non-trivial. I will discuss a little about this later. Then the third component is compatibility with ramification theory. So in particular, the reciprocity map sends high ramification groups to locally to higher groups of principal units. So this compatibility with ramification theory is fundamental to classical class field theory, and this compatibility breaks down in for higher class field theory, unfortunately. But in one-dimensional case, this is very classical. And finally, explicit formulas. And this is what is very, very important, explicit formulas for the Hilbert symbol. So this is the fourth component, explicit formulas for the Hilbert symbol. So of course, class field theory is difficult and very arithmetical theory. But from my perspective, the real heart of arithmetic of class field theory is here, in explicit formulas for the Hilbert symbol. So remember that Hilbert asked two problems about class field theory. One was about generalization of special class field theory. The second was exactly this one. So this is Hilbert problem 9. Just get explicit formulas for the Hilbert residue symbol. This is related, of course, to Gauss quadratic reciprocity map, its generalizations, and so on. But it is here where we have amazing variety of explicit formulas, which are really important because of their use in, for example, in the work on Bertschwinner-Tendai conjecture and arithmetic of abelian varieties. So the point is, again, we want to have some more explicit information about class field theory in order to apply to the study of arithmetic of interesting objects already, like abelian varieties over local fields. And in particular, in Vasava theory, this explicit formula, by the way, Vasava theory is still a special type theory, even though it's not class field theory. So in Vasava theory, it uses this explicit formulas of various types. So many formulas, but amazingly, or maybe not amazingly, there are formulas of special type which work over special fields. And so they include, in particular, formulas by Artin-Hase, Iwasawa, Coates, Weil, Scato, many others. And then formulas of general type. And here, not so many formulas, so it started with Shafarevich, and then was continued by Vostokov, and then by me and various other people. So similar to class field theory of special type and general type, for explicit formulas, we have similar situations that actually explicit formulas of general type are simpler than explicit formulas of special type. And moreover, explicit formulas of general type work over any field and imply all explicit formulas of special type, well, with some additional work, but essentially imply. So in fact, it's sufficient to know only one explicit formula of general type, and then you can derive all other special explicit formulas and apply them. So here I wanted to explain Vostokov's explicit formula, but it is very essentially related to Shafarevich's work. And maybe 5 minutes is enough in order to state this formula. Again, this formula is not so complicated, and moreover, it has various features similar to Artin-Schreier-Witt pairing, even though it's in characteristic zero and this is in characteristic P. So here we are talking about Wild-Hilbert symbol, of course. So we are talking about so-called Hilbert symbol, which is the pairing of this with itself for local fields of mixed characteristic to H1 times H1 and then to H2, which will be isomorphic to mu m. So this is a Hilbert symbol. So we assume that K contains m's roots, Pm's roots of unity. So the task is, so this is defined using the reciprocity map. The task is to find explicit formula. And so I will write the answer then. So the answer is the general formula. The most powerful, so to say, is, so we choose a primitive Pm's root of unity, and then again there is trace, again there is residue. And then there is something a little more mysterious and very fundamental for arithmetic local fields. The product of two terms like this, phi AB times phi. So the trace and residue correspond to the trace and the residue here. And also there will be lifts similar to characteristic P. But phi is a little more complicated than this. It's just a little more complicated than this. So I won't really to tell this without hurry, so maybe I will continue on Friday. So on Friday I will give the formula for this term and also for this very interesting term. Which makes this formula, explicit formula, fundamentally different from anything in characteristic P, because in characteristic P we don't have denominators, but here V will have a denominator related to Pm's root of unity. So this will be very interesting phenomena. So I can only say that there are many modern ways to deduce these formulas, and one of them uses so-called syntomic cohomologies. And these syntomic cohomologies actually just, in some sense, Galois cohomology formalism, in some sense, underlying these explicit formulas. Right, so I'll then stop. So still, exercise one remains, because as stated, it is correct, and definitely it can be proved. For exercise two, I will check what is wrong in the statement, and I will tell you on Friday. And please prepare your questions. I am addressing students from Kyoto University. If you need to have some pass related to this course, then if you ask some questions, we'll give you this pass. If you don't ask questions, we also give you this pass, but a little later. And does anyone have this list of the names which... Ah, excellent. Thank you very much. So please enjoy the rest of the day, and we'll meet on Friday. Thank you.